Happy Easter, everyone. He is risen. Okay, well, thanks so much for joining us on this beautiful day the Lord has made, this Easter Sunday, to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We would ask that you now please rise and join us in our opening selection.
Mary does is I wait for direction. Yeah, you can give direction. Again, God has blessed us to see another Resurrection Sunday. And so it's just a blessing to see each and every one of your faces. I invite you to greet one another. You don't have to walk around. Just kind of turn around and shake your hand. Glad to see you. And as we come back to our seats, we're blessed as you sit to focus on the piano to my right there, Miss Gracie Potts. God is blessing us with another selection from one of our special young people.
About how you came near to us and you gave your life for us and you went into the tomb and 3 days later you did arise from the dead and you live and we rejoice because you have risen and because you live we can face whatever we may be facing today and we can face tomorrow, whatever may come our way. And we sing with rejoicing, knowing that you, Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, Christ Jesus made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in the human likeness, and being found in the appearance of a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God our Father. And yes, Father, we give you all that we are. We love you with all that we are, with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind and strength. We dedicate to you and confess that you are Lord. And we believe in our hearts that you, our Father in heaven, raised your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, from the dead. And we give you praise that we can have life eternal. That life eternal that we can embrace the life here and now, rejoicing and proclaiming all that you are. And we are not a people to be pitied, but we are a people that have hope. And we are a people that can rejoice. And we are a people that through the power of your Spirit can share the reason for our hope. And so, Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us. And we continue in an attitude of prayer, remembering the prayer that our Lord Jesus Christ taught his disciples to pray, and praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Our scripture reading comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verse 18. It comes from the New International Version. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to her.
Close encounters of the first kind, sightings of an unidentified flying object. Close encounters of the second kind, physical evidence of a UFO. Close encounters of the third kind, actual contact. Columbia Pictures in association with EMI.
Now, of course, we're not about to see a movie. But for some of us, it seems like that was yesterday, wasn't it, Larry? You know, the Close Encounters movies was one of those movies that it was kind of like a seminal moment in my life where I imagined that there was something beyond this world. I could envision those little aliens coming off the ship, and I wondered what it would be like to encounter an extraterrestrial or something that's different than me. And then I think about this morning where we have been reminded in the scriptures that there was a different close encounter. And I could envision this close encounter of the fourth kind, an encounter with the Holy Spirit. How awesome is that? An encounter with God, but yet, if we were to read that whole section from John, the 20th chapter, verses 1 through 18, we would hear and could envision a scene that boggles my imagination. The empty tomb, the beloved disciple Peter, and I would say one who was probably just as beloved, Mary Magdalene gathered there to take care of Jesus' body and to continue and to complete the last rites, if you would. But when they come to that tomb, they don't find the body. They don't find his remains. They find these linen cloths, these things that entwined his body. At one point, they find a stone possibly that he rested upon, but they don't find his body. Close encounters, not just of this extraterrestrial supernatural phenomenon, but something intimate and personal. Something that gets to the very core of who we are as God's people. This holy encounter, if you would, that Mary had with Jesus was one that begs us to ask the question, how do we see Jesus? How are we encountered by Jesus? Is it even important that we encounter Jesus? Some have told me in the past that they are a member of a church, that they were brought to the church when they were an infant. Now, that didn't happen at this church, but at another church. And I said to them, you know, that's marvelous. Do you know Jesus? And they again repeated for me that they were historical members of that congregation. Now, for those who may not know it, my family goes way back in Methodist history, and I rejoice that I can read documents and see my great-grandfather's name on church documents where he was a leading layperson complaining to the bishop about his pastor. But yet, I think Easter Sunday morning invites us to analyze where we are in our relationship and where we are in this, not just sacred moment, but opportunity to encounter Jesus. When I think about the unique perspective of the resurrection in the Gospel of John, I am intrigued that it did not focus on the physical as much as it does the relationship. A friend of mine says it's all about the relationship that Mary and Jesus had. It's all about recognizing God's presence through relationships, through love and intimate moments with one who cares about you so greatly. I am reminded that some of us struggle this morning with that relationship. Some of us say that story is one that's a good fairy tale to tell the kids back in children's church, Brad, but I just can't connect with that spiritual thing you're talking about. But you see, that again is what I believe this Sunday morning is all about. I believe that this Sunday morning invites us to go beyond our mere physical context. You see, in the Gospel of Mark, we get more of a physical description and more details, if you would, of Mark the historian. But in John, we are invited into this faith relationship more so. Now, yes, there is a nice story to go with it because we like stories. We are people of the story, but it's more than Mary. It's more than Peter racing back to tell the other disciples that Jesus is alive, that he has risen. Now, people like me for a couple centuries now have struggled with how can we make this story fresh and new to a crowd who probably only comes because you already know it? How can I make this something that doesn't put you right to sleep, Emily? I'm going to do a YouTube show. But I don't have to do that, I think. I believe that part of the joy of today is that we can repackage, we can rebrand, we can reconnect with the energy that Peter had when he raced back to the disciples. We can reconnect with the emotion and the extreme sorrow that Mary had at the beginning of it when she did not find the body of her Lord, but yet when she realized finally that this figure that she had been talking to and had imagined was a gardener was actually Jesus. But it was only when he called her name that she recognized this. When he said, Mary, Mary, don't you recognize? She could connect when her name was called. Now, I am terrible with names. And Val, it's taken me a long time to get a lot of people's names here, and now they're going to be moving me. But names are important. People need to know that they are important. Every individual needs to know that we are important to God, and that Jesus reaffirmed that not just as he called Mary's name in their significant relationship, but that as we who represent the Marys of this world, we who come with our burdens, we who come with our disappointments, we who struggle to make sense out of this world when we think we've got it all figured out and then things get turned upside down. Somebody gets laid off from a job. Someone we care about comes down with a disease like my 3-year-old niece with leukemia. Someone we care about is struggling with a relationship. Some family is struggling just to hold it all together when everything we put our hope in gets turned upside down. And Jesus says to us, there's something about a holy encounter. Now, everybody, as I said, can't get with that. Some people struggle because of the intellectual capacities that they have. Some people believe in this technological age that we live in the 21st century. That just sounds magical to somebody at my age. I remember it as a kid. There were going to be all these magical inventions and contraptions that were going to take place in this 21st century, and now that we're here, it's just another day. But God is doing something new and fresh in each and every day. There was one such guy back in the 70s. You remember the 70s, Janet? You know, that was couple lifetimes ago. Yeah, Craig, there were people who lived in 1971. And there was this guy. Yeah, I like getting to use, you know, they know if they go to sleep, I'm calling their name. Named Alistair McGrath. And he thought he was a pretty smart guy back in England. And he was in high school and he had just won a scholarship to Oxford University. And that's quite a big deal over in the British part of the world, and kind of over in this part of the world too. And he had finished up what we would call his high school preparation, and he had this gap in between starting Oxford and finishing high school, and he had this list of books that he was going to read. Now, I got to digress just a moment here to say that Alistair McGrath at this point in his life thought that he knew everything. He was probably around 17 to 19, and he thought he knew everything. Now, I know there are no 17, 16-year-olds, or 18-year-olds, or 19-year-olds here today who would think they know everything, right? You don't know everything, do you? Yeah. No, you don't. But yet, he did. And what he knew was there is no God. This God stuff is for those folks who lived in the magical make-believe world. He was a person of science. He just won this science scholarship to Oxford. And so, in the meantime, as he would say, a car-carrying atheist, he was going to read this list of improvement books.
And in this list of improvement books was a book called Plato's Republic. Now, if you've never read it, I have. Plato's Republic will put you right to sleep. To me, there's nothing inspirational in it. But yet, when he was reading Plato's Republic, there was a story in it of a group of people, and in those days, it was all, you know, male-oriented, I'll say it, sexist. So a group of men were trapped in this cave. And in the cave, there was a fire. And from the flames of the fire, as anyone who's been outside can tell you, you can get, you know, images, flickers from the light that comes off of the fire. And on the wall of the cave, behind them, their images would flicker on the wall of the cave from the fire. Well, Alistair is told in this writing that the men thought that was the totality of the world. What they saw in the flickering of the fire in that cave. And as he got close to the end of that story, in the end of that reading, he, a card-carrying atheist, he, one who had won a science scholarship to Oxford University, he began to wonder. He began to think. Let me just read one of his quotes. He says, the typical atheist superstition might be that there was something else. Alistair says, what you see is what you get. And that is the end of the matter. What you see is what you get. Yet, a still small voice within him whispered words of doubt. Words like this. What if this world is only part of the story? What if this world is only a shadow land? What if there is something more wonderful beyond this world? I say to you this morning, what if there's something more? What if the resurrection story is really true? What if the Holy Spirit continues to walk amongst us in Jesus' stead and engages us and invites us to not just this world, but into another world? What if Jesus' love offers us something beyond the shadowlands? What if? Let's see if we have a little video that moves us further down there.
What rock? There's no rock here. Not anymore. It's in all the walls that sin put up for thousands of years. We're all of a sudden gone. That rock sat there taunting and intimidating. The sin and bad guys won. Our followers were left undead. Said he was dead, I could change their story. From that moment on, every single person could peer into the shadows and find that you can put truth in a grave, but it won't stay there. Today is Easter. It marks the fulfillment and freedom we receive because of Jesus' sacrifice.
What he did rocks. Now, if you don't take anything else from this service today, if somebody says, what did you encounter at that church there next to Casey's? You know that's how some people know it. They don't know the name of this building. They just know it's the church next to Casey's. You can say, Jesus rocks. Now, so what do you mean by that? I would invite you to say that it's not just in the story that we are invigorated, but It's in the seeking of Jesus in our daily lives. Now, I'm going to tell you, I'm excited today. I'm going to tell you, I'm uplifted. I'm going to also tell you that I was so nervous about the beginning of the day that I woke up and I said, Daddy, you remember that time I was preaching and my nose started bleeding and it wouldn't stop bleeding before service? I had one of those moments. And so I'm sitting in my office in between service with a big ice pack over my nose. And I was thinking, you know, this is awesome. These people here are awesome, not just because you're great people. Jeff, I got you in the back there, see. I told you I was going to call you. But you are all awesome because God calls us to be the beloved community. Now, you say, Brad, what do you mean about this beloved community? Well, we're told that Peter was the beloved disciple. And I'm going to tell you, I'm adding Mary to that because since there was a lot of sexism in the Bible, I think Mary got left out on that note. So it was Mary and Peter together as the beloved disciples here. Jesus, once they recognized him, invited them to go back to the community and tell them about what had happened. Tell them that he was not dead on a slab. Tell them that they had encountered him. Tell them that they had spoken to Jesus. Tell them that he invited them to go out and tell other people as a community. To me, one of the great things that happens here when we gather, one of the reasons that I was so nervous, one of the reasons that I get so excited, is that it's in community that we are able to grow in our relationships with God. It's in community that we are able to support one another and love one another. And yes, I know it's in community that we can say some pretty bad stuff to one another too, but hey, it's the Holy Spirit that kind of levels all of that out. But we cannot do that as individuals. That we need each other. Somebody said to me, you know, Brad, I'm just fine by myself. I don't need those other hypocrites. Notice I said other hypocrites. I don't need those people inside that church building. I just believe you meet Jesus by yourself. Now, yes, we do meet Jesus by ourselves. But Jesus invites us to live in community, the beloved community, and then to share that with a world that needs to know they are beloved too. This morning, I believe that, yes, Jesus rocks. Yes, we have a great story to tell, not just to the nations, but to our neighbors, to our friends, to our family. Ooh, that's a real scary one. Our families. But to a world that's beckoning and yearning and seeking and hoping and struggling. Then yes, we have a joy this morning, but it's not because everything is all right. We have a joy because Jesus meets us where we are. Jesus calls our names wherever we are in our journeys. And he walks with us, as the songwriter says. And he talks with us. Now for him to talk with us, we've got to be open to listen. And he tells us that we are his own. This morning, I believe we are invited to meet the Good Shepherd Jesus. This Good Shepherd. This loving Father. This compassionate brother. This sympathetic sister. This healing master, Jesus. You know, if you don't get anything else about our brief, but I hope, unique encounter, not just this morning, but over the last 3.5 years, is that God works in mysterious ways. Never would imagine that God would have done this in Elmwood, Illinois, through a slightly portly fella named Bradley Watkins. As I say, the slight. This morning, never would have imagined ministries of compassion and hope. Ministries that care about people and and senior facilities and nursing homes and families that are going through transitions of life and death in their lives. Never would have imagined ministries that care about families seeking to stay together and hold together and build on something more solid than the American cultural perspective. Never would have imagined opportunities to speak hope and light into corners of darkness where people struggle with mental illness and mental health discrepancies. Never would have imagined. But when we hear Jesus call our names, all things are possible for those who love the Lord. I invite our worship leaders back up at this time so that we can continue in that spirit of anticipation, that spirit of hope, that spirit of joy, you know, that spirit of not just racing back like Peter did, but that spirit of truly taking a moment to encounter Jesus like Mary did. Will the ushers prepare to come forward? And again, I thank you for your faithfulness. I can't imagine a more supportive, loving, and compassionate group of people than you sitting here and the people I've met in and through this wonderful congregation. You allow us to touch people in our neighborhoods, in our towns, around the world because of your generosity. Thank you again.
Thank you.
so much for joining us for worship this morning. If you'll please rise and join us in our closing selection.
They are, and God calls them to love others. Go forth with that love in your heart. Go forth with that truth in your mind. Go forth with the belief that there's something beyond this shadow land that we call earth. That something is heaven. Amen.